Bible, please turn back to John chapter 10. That'd be really helpful. I'm going to be particularly focusing on verses 7 to 10 of John chapter 10. Why don't I read that to us? Therefore, Jesus said again, "Very truly, I tell you, I am the gate for the sheep. All who have come before me are thieves and robbers, but the sheep have not listened to them. I am the gate. Whoever enters through me will be saved. They will come in and out and find pasture. The thief comes only to steal and kill and destroy. I have come that they may have life and have it to the full." Let's pray together. Jesus, we thank you for this great promise. You have come to give us life to the full, an abundant, rich life. Lord, as we spend these next few minutes looking at these verses, I pray for myself, Lord, that I'd be clear. I pray for us all that we have hearts and ears wanting to hear the great shepherd you speaking to us. Amen. I wonder what your picture of life to the full looks like. What is that abundant life? There's lots of kind of ordinary daily stuff we have to do. You know, the chores around the house, at work. And there's great value in that, and I'm sure great enjoyment. But what really gets you going? What for you is life to the full? But just pause for a moment and try and get something in your head. What does life to the full look like for you? Numerous things perhaps you're thinking of, or that we could rattle off quickly. Relationships, a marriage, money, money and the power that money gives. What about this? What about power? And the control that power can bring. Power to be able to do things. Power over people. Power over circumstances. Or if we're using the language of Jesus, being a gatekeeper. Being a gatekeeper is one who has power. Politicians are gatekeepers. They have power. And they want to guide sheep, people, through their gates, into their political party. And they promise you an abundant life once you're in. Vote for us, they say, and bring in, and we'll bring in our manifestos, our policies, and the nation will have abundant life. That's what they promise. And if our recent local elections are anything to go by, we're not going to find abundant life in the Conservatives for much longer. What about us? Could we be those gatekeepers? Those people with power and influence? What about us as a church? Could we be gatekeepers within a church, within God's setting, if you like? Dictating who we think should and shouldn't be in God's kingdom. Who should and shouldn't be allowed into church. And if we are that sort of gatekeeper, then when the right people come in, according to our criteria, we're happy. But then when the wrong sorts come in, oh, we're not very happy at all, but this is the wrong sort. God doesn't want those people in his kingdom. I wonder if we could be the gatekeepers. In Jesus' day, the gatekeepers were the religious establishment. The Pharisees that we had in our reading of chapter 10 and verse 1. That's who Jesus is talking to. And in the story before, in John chapter 9, Jesus has had a run-in with the gatekeepers. With the religious establishment of his day. And they don't like him. They really don't like Jesus because he's a threat to them. He's a threat to their power and to their control that they think they have over the people. And so they're doing all they can to be hostile and get rid of him. And the particular incident in mind in chapter 9 is that Jesus has just healed a man who was blind from birth. but he did it to their dislike on the Sabbath. You see, rather than seeing that this was a wonderful sign that the sent Son from heaven had come to earth, which is what it was when Jesus did this miracle, they're hostile instead. And they do all they can to kind of try and dismiss it. They go to his parents and say, well, he wasn't really born blind, was he? Because then Jesus didn't have to heal him from blind. He wasn't blind from birth. And then they twice question the man himself, trying to get him to change his story and say that Jesus didn't do this. They are so, so hostile to Jesus. And so then when we come into chapter 10 and Jesus talks about thieves and robbers, he's not talking about literal thieves and robbers of sheep. He's talking about the gatekeepers. He's talking about the religious people trying to steal people from the Lord. We too can be those religious gatekeepers. We too can be those thieves. If rules is what dominates us, if rules is what we're really interested in, then Jesus would say we're like those thieves and the robbers. Because we've dismissed Jesus, we've put him as secondary under our religious rules. So when we find ourselves saying things like, well, Christians, God's people, they shouldn't be doing any sport on a Sunday. There shouldn't be any shopping on a Sunday. When we say things like, well, Christians must read their Bible for at least 20 minutes a day and pray for 10 minutes a day. And when Christians come to church, they should only wear certain clothes. Or we have to have this Bible translation only. We can find ourselves making up rules. And Jesus would say to us, we're like those thieves and those robbers. We are making ourselves gatekeepers. We're dictating what is acceptable to God and what isn't. So religion and religious rules kills. But Jesus hasn't come to kill us, the total opposite. Look back at chapter 10 and verse 9 and 10 again, would you? What's Jesus come to give us? What does it say?
Life.
Life to the full. It's the total opposite, isn't it? So while religious people are wanting to kill us, Jesus is wanting to save us. He wants to give us the best life possible. You see, he made that outrageous claim. He says, I am the gate. I'm the gate for safety, the gate for salvation, and the gate for an abundant life. If we want to know what life to the full is about, it's found in a relationship with Jesus. Not rules, but a relationship. You see, if we're going down that rules-based route, we'll never be confident that we've done enough. If we think God accepts us on the basis of rule-keeping, we'll always be worried, have I kept enough rules today? Have I done enough good things today to earn a relationship? And we'll never make it. We'll fail day after day. But Jesus hasn't come to give us rules. He's come to give us a relationship with himself. Think back to those sheep that we read about in the first few verses of John chapter 10. The sheep, the people know the shepherd's voice. And he calls them individually by name. There's an intimacy here, isn't there? Jesus knows us. He knows his people intimately. He loves us. We're dearly loved children. He protects us. All those wonderful relational terms that we can think of, Jesus is offering us. That's the invitation that he's giving us. Have this abundant life is what Jesus is inviting us to. Not by following rules, but by having a relationship with me. But a relationship is a two-way thing, isn't it? A And an invitation can be given, but has to be accepted. So what should our response to this invitation be? What's our side of keeping the relationship? Well, look at chapter 10 and verse 4, if you will. Can someone tell me, what do the sheep do? They can hear. They hear and they follow. That's us. The right response to Jesus is to follow him. And when we realize that he's the great shepherd who gave up his life for us, who selflessly gave up everything for us, then that's not a chore. It's a delight to follow our loving shepherd. That's why Jesus can come and offer abundant life, life to the full. And the great thing is with this life to the full, it keeps on going. You see, you might think, well, when death comes, it stops. But actually, the remarkable thing about it is that death is just a gateway to an even more abundant life. As we're face to face with Jesus in glory. Isn't that amazing? That's the life that Jesus has come to offer us, that even goes through death. But maybe it still seems a bit abstract, a bit kind of out there, a bit kind of churchy and doctrinal. Okay, well, what does it look like on the ground? What does abundant life, life to the full look like? Well, we see it in John chapter 9 with this man who is born blind. Think through his life to start with before he met Jesus. Dependent upon probably just about everybody else. Unable to do many things for himself. An outcast in society. He's at home and he trips over his brother's shoes and falls over and hurts himself. He can embrace his mother and feel the embrace of her hug, but has no idea what she looks like. And then one day he's out and he meets Jesus, who sees him and spits on the ground and mixes his saliva with the mud and smears it across his face and says, go and wash in the pool of Siloam and you'll be healed. You'll be able to see again. And he does, and he can. Here is a man who can now see again. Think about the transformation. He goes back home. He sees for the first time his mother, who embraces him and says, son, this is magnificent. This is marvelous. He says, it is, isn't it? And just watch the stove, Mum, because the pot's about to boil over. He sees the shoes of his brother and just pushes them to the side. A few days later, he's back out on the street. And Jesus again bumps into him. Let's pick the story up in John. Chapter 10, verse 35. John chapter 9, verse 35. This man's been thrown out of the synagogue. Jesus heard that they had thrown him out, and when he found him, he said, do you believe in the Son of Man? Who is he, sir? The man asked. Tell me that I may believe in him. Jesus said, you have now seen him. In fact, he's the one speaking with you. Then the man said, Lord, I believe. Because he's not just got a new physical life, being able to see, he now has a new spiritual life. He worships Jesus. That's the right response, isn't it? That's abundant life. Being known by the great shepherd who loves us and knows us intimately, and us in response, bowing down, not just on a Sunday, but everywhere, and saying, I give my life now for the great shepherd who loves me. This is a quote from C.S. Lewis, and we begin to think about what our response should be. To fool about with earthly pleasures or religion when infinite joy is offered us is like an ignorant child who wants to go on making mud pies in a slum because he cannot imagine what is meant by the offer of a holiday at the sea. Think of abundant life being that holiday by the sea. It's on offer to us from Jesus today. We'd be foolish, wouldn't we, to carry on playing with mud puppies when the offer of abundant life is offered to us. Let's pray. Lord, we thank you for this great invitation to have this relationship with you, this abundant life. Lord, please help us to joyfully accept that offer and live for you. Don't allow us to be fools any longer. Forgive us, Lord, when we put rules ahead of you, when we think that people should conform to our standards or our beliefs. Lord, please forgive us and help us to find that joy that comes from knowing you.